looking at the time frame, I'll not take much more than hardly 10 minutes to share what exactly I want to tell before you. Let me tell that I am basically an anthropologist who has remained for the last 24 years in the India's northeast to distinguish a kind of an illusory space to many of us, and this presentation is in relation to a state called Arunachal Pradesh, where I was located for the last 19 years before I shifted over to this National Museum. Just a few lines in relation to Arunachal. This is a state, I think most of you must be aware of, which is largely in circulation of our national media in relation to the additional Chinese playing over large part of its territory. And that has led to a kind of an huge circulation in the media. And our national media like NDTV, they had to organize a big fight in order to sensitize this state of Arunachal to the larger people of our country, our nation, whom we have passionately termed as the mainstream population. What exactly I am? As I told, I am an anthropologist, not any kind of an opinion in terms of the architecture as such. But during my presence in this last 19 years, I had a chance to visit to the larger segments of Arunachal, interacting with the people of Arunachal, the tribal people of Arunachal. Almost cross-section of which are our students itself within the university system we have access. And I stayed for a longer time. As you know, as an anthropologist, we don't intend to look for an understanding of any issue we can think of in terms of this environment. To me, the understanding of any vernacular architecture you can think of, it is simply not possible. Somebody lands up in a space and trying to measure it with great authenticity, with tools and other things. You cannot understand the architecture, because to my understanding, these houses or these structures are much more beyond their physicality. There is no doubt about the kind of the traditional knowledge system which is involved in terms of the technology which is associated, in terms of utilizations of the different kinds of raw materials which they try to engage in terms of the construction process from their local surroundings, which is great, which is definitely amazing. But then beyond that, there is a larger domain which remains, and to an anthropologist, I think that becomes much more appealing to me, because to me, if you want to understand a specific structure, I'm talking about in the context of the temple architecture and more specifically in relation to Arunachal, it also represents a kind of a social order. It also talks about the question of social structure and even the question of social inequality which remains within these, the idea of the tribe, Adivasi, or whatever, or the kind of nomenclature you can go on being perceiving in terms of the conventional ideas of tribe as a kind of the representation of some kind of egalitarian social structure. These are largely a kind of a myth, which is also perhaps kind of reflected or understood through the study of the different kinds of tribal architecture which you can think of. Now what I have tried to do, out of my hundreds of collections, is basically kind of in certain visual images, and I will give some elementary commentary with that, reflecting some of my crude, I repeat it, crude understanding about the question of the linking of vernacular architecture, here it is obviously the tribal architecture, and the kind of the social reality, the kind of change which has pervaded their social life in the phase of what we call the globalization and liberalization, which becomes almost passwords for understanding the social realities today. Now this is, of course, because of too much of my visual images are not that much interesting. It's basically you can see the extension of a kind of a structure which is largely related to Wancho house, which will come later on. As I told, let me just add Arunachal again in a very brief way. It's essentially a tribal state, as you know. We talk about 26 major tribes. We talk about almost 100 small tribes. And physically, let me also add that Arunachal is the largest state in Northeast India. Though in terms of population, it is around 12 lakhs of population is remaining within the state. Now, you can have a look to, this is an Adi village. Perhaps not that much of clear, it could have been given much better shape. I'm just trying to give you an idea about the settlement patterns of the Adi, which is considered as one of the dominant numerically in terms of the political implications also. This is the settlement pattern itself. Now, just trying to come to this specific structure. I don't have right now the measurements with you, but this is a huge structure which they call their mates dormitory. In their local term, it is called B-E-R-E. But you can add just like three another blocks while we are sitting here. You can add three or four blocks. That will be the structure of a dormitory, which is very central to the any village which you can think of in relation to the others. Now when a new village construction comes up, this is the first structure which comes up in the village. And then the corresponding structure will start making for the villagers itself. This is the another view. And why this become important, which I was talking about. Now this dormitory remains as the lifeline of the village itself, where at least 300 to 400 villagers can sit inside and they can discuss about their agricultural processes. They can decide when they are going to start their journey process. When it comes to the question of celebration of the festival, the different aspects which relates to that celebration, that is decided within this space. And so far the question of transmission of knowledge from one generation to another, there are different kinds of crafts whether it is the question of masquerading, whether it is the question of nurturing their polar tradition from one generation to another. Now this is the space which I was showing you the dormitory. That becomes itself as an institution within the village, which you can perceive in terms of the transmission of their indigenous knowledge with the whole domain of culture itself. So what I was trying to focus basically this aspect of the structure is not just to measure it, it's about to measure and try to understand the raw materials. Unless you understand this whole larger ethnographic process, I think this mere structure will not lead us anywhere. Now this is basically a construction of a new house, and in this same Adi village, and you can see the activities inside that there is the dormitory which is going. It's a huge population gathering there, having different kinds of activities, leading to a kind of a new construction of a house. To my understanding, many of our discussion remain too much focused on this technology, raw materials and others, which is obviously very much important. But what is missing many a time, it is the people who actually holds that the idea or the structure itself which you have talked about. So some photographs I try to put forward here. Now again, because of the question of when durability came, some of these bays today, they have restructured their, you can see the rooftop is replaced by the tin sheets. Some of the ritual activity which is also part of the existence of that institution is here. Now let me just add another point in relation to this dormitory which you are talking about. Today if you visit an Adi village, I think out of 100 Adi villages, hardly 4 or 5 villages which are quite interior, need to have a one-day foot march, you can find such structures are still existing. Otherwise, there is another structure from the gods also, which is no more in the village. And in some villages, this so-called dormitories are changed into a kind of a community club, where some functions are taking place. So what I am basically talking about, the kind of change which has inflicted in the community and leading to the kind of loss of such kind of an institution itself. Now these are some, again, visual images. These are granaries basically. Hardly anyone of us talked about, we have talked about their house, but there are very interesting work can be done on the storage of food. This is a typical Adi granary, which is generally remains far away from their traditional houses, because any time those traditional houses can be linked to a kind of fire accidents. It is the granaries which holds the village, which is their lifeline. So these are kept much separated away from the main settlement pattern. Again, some these are the granaries. Now coming to another part of Arunachal, the Jido Apatani Valley. I don't know any one of you, some of you must have visited the valley itself. I appeal to you as an anthropologist, as a person whose life Arunachal makes a presence, please try to find out time and visit to the Apatani Valley, especially during their cultivation time. It's a different world altogether. And Apatanis have known how they have managed every inch of their land for the cultivation process, and through which they have sustained a huge population. Now these are again the granaries. This is the settlement of Apatanis, for which you need to understand their the clan organization, basically their social structure or the basis of which these villages are organized. And then, being such kind of a structure where there is extreme climate itself, during winter, there is so much of cold. And these structures are, every year we find in some Apatani hamlets, some or other sites, completely burned out of fire. Fire accidents are very prone to be happening. But they have an excellent social mechanism through which you will see within 2 days of burning an Apatani village, the entire village is again reconstructed. So again, I am trying to focus about the larger question of the community, or the question of understanding the social organization or the structural issue, which is very, very important, perhaps central to the larger understanding of any kind of vernacular architecture you can think of. This is very important. In Arunachal, again, I am back to, there are tradition of longhouse with some of the tribes. And that longhouse is just looking like a kind of a train. 3-4, as I told you, you can have such structures. Machines are one of them, who are in the Vivangali, who are in the Ayodhya also. Some of our again, is that some structure of the Vishnu house. I'm not talking about the internal division of the space within the structure. This is the if you look at this Durkheim's notion of sacred and profane, no? Sacred or the ritual space. The internal division of space are very structured. Again, which needs an understanding about their ritual processes, ritual dimensions of the community. You can see the different kinds of animal bones are here. These are considered very sacred space for the, it's not much visible. You can see the large number of animal heads are here. It's a huge, a kind of an, say around, depending on, of course, the house itself and the economic capability of the individual, you can find a complete wall with hundreds of animal skulls. Many of those animals, perhaps today, even extinct from the community or the area. Because again, you know, people started in terms of replacing their traditional materials and looking for the wooden structures of such long houses. This is again Nokte House, Indira. It's a very old photograph. This is also, just to give an idea about the structure itself, I'll just come to this issue later on. Now the Nishi Longhouse, I'll just pass over a few information. Today, again, hardly Nishi Longhouse, which they call Nanda, N-A-N-D-A, is hardly visible. Out of the whole Nishi areas, which is very spread in Arunachal, very selective few villages you can get. Now this house traditionally represent a kind of a political entity for the community itself. Such a house accommodated from 80 to 100 individuals within this house. And how effectively that people are inside the house is organized, that determining whether that village or the community or the population within that house will remain or not. I'm talking about the so-called days, 50 years, 100 years down the lane. If you look at the initial documents, there are so much of feuds within the community, across the community, that the very housing of 100 population within a structure which worked as a political entity for the survival of that population itself. So I am trying to focus on that kind of a dimension, which also relates to the question of the shape and size. Today have we found, as I told you, these numbers, that these are some comfy structure. It's a Buddhist time, I'm not going into that detail. I'll come to our plan in relation to this museum, where we we are planning to build a Wancho house. Look at this structure. You know, Wanchos are having what we call the chieftainship system. They are communities, what we call in terms of social inequalities, divided with the chiefs and commoners. And we need to understand that social organization to be understanding what their clan organizations. Now this is the chief's house, which is again huge, massive. I'll come to that again. This is the dormitory again. But the Wanchos, the dormitory, as some of you must be having some idea, is that the Wanchos are located in Indira district, pretty closer to the border of Nagaland. If you are aware of the issue of Greater Nagaland, on which the huge issue is going on, NSAN and all this, the idea of Greater Nagaland, Wanchos are also included. Now this dormitory, again, historically remains the lifeline. How effectively a dormitory is operating within the village, it is located in such a strategic way in a village. Again, the question of the huge feuds inter-community, it is between Wanchos and Nagaris and many other communities surrounding. The location of, strategic location of dormitory, and how effectively the people inside the dormitory are organized themselves, that has defined the existence of that village itself, village population. Otherwise, the whole villagers can be eliminated in terms of that kind of an feud or the community, inter-community clashes. Now this is inside the, what is called the, perhaps the biggest musical ground available with the communities. Again, just like the Adis, with the dormitories where the transmission of knowledge, folklore, rural tradition, even when the people are going to cultivate or burn their shaping fields, the decision is taken inside the boys' dormitory. They have the tradition of girls' dormitory also, which is not a separate structure, generally remains within a village, some village elder's house, there is a provision of girls' dormitory, which is no more exist. These boys' dormitories are also almost disappeared from the community. There are multiple reasons associated with that. This is some of the Utkarvi options are known for their Utkarvi skills. It is not the selective individual. The whole villagers effortlessly they can carve an excellent piece from any kind of a wood from their simplest tool which they have. Now these are the skills which are stored inside the dormitory. This is some of the staircase from where we grew. You can see the kind of a curvature there. Again, back to the chief's house. Look at this chief's house, that photograph which I was taking when first I walked in that area around 1999-2000. Just 1 month back I was there with some of our curatorial staff. That structure is replaced by this one. The chief was converted that whole structure, and this is the structure which came out as a replacement. And see the chief's house, it's almost holding the different kinds of, I'll say the material, cultural markers of the community. I'll just illustrate this one. This is a, what we call the modern passive for grinding the mills, which is their staple core. You can see the holes inside. A chief is allowed to keep such a structure where you can find at least 10 such holes. That means 10 girls, or do you mean they will stand different sides and they can go on using their modern passive? The commoners, whether you are talking about their social division, will never found in commoners' heart such structure which will be more than 2 holes. A commoner people belongs to, you need to understand their land structure, even they are economically capable. they cannot think of having such kind of a structure which will have more than two rooms. So that I am talking about in terms of the symbolic nature of this architecture. Now the chief's house is replaced, so they kept, this is no more, nobody takes care of such structure. It was kept still with some kind of an structure. These are the coco leaves which are usually grown and used for the thatching of their roofs. Now what we have decided, we have invited Wanchus from the villages, and recently they have visited our village. We have taken through our tribal habitat, and then they went back to the village and they have collectively decided to build up a kind of a structure in our tribal habitat. Now this is the process is on. You can see they have already started collecting the toko leaves and started packing, which will be transported here. We have different government procedures which they were looking getting delayed. Now this is some of the visuals. You can see the extended, the length of structure. These are basically done. Say this kind of in households, every after 5 or 10 years you need to replace the beams. Now these extensions basically allow them to use that same log. Instead of replacing the extended part, then go below the arc. So the same logs or dugen beams they can use in a multiple time. And this is the reason for this kind of an extension which you can see at the rooftop. Now these are the new innovation which is also taken in the village life. People who are working, some of our staff, you can see the village structures and essentially there. Now this is the church. Now the huge structure which is village chief used to have, that is no more. You have seen the new structure. But this is the church. Today almost the 80% or more than that is converted to the Christian. The church has taken up that similar structure, and you can see this. This is the central village church within the Wancho village. They are maintaining, they have constructed this, their so-called the vernacular chief structure. Now this is the village chief. You can see behind, while he is sitting, there is a dormitory. As per their norm, again just one or two sentences, a village chief has his own dormitory, which they call in local term PANU, P-A-N-U, where during the days of headhunting, there are a lot of debate today in terms of suffixing the word hunting. Headhunting, whether it is a really meaningful word in relation to the kind of practice they are. But after, if we take the headhunting also, the enemy's heads are kept inside the PANU, the village chief's dormitory, and along with many other things. Now, you see the village chief sitting in front of his dormitory, which is no more, nobody takes care. Inside there is a log drum which is almost decaying. Now this is the kind of the realities which part of our existence. Now as I have told, once we have decided community agreed to come and install the kind of Wancho house, they have also started creating this log drums where we are sitting basically. The many other things which remains part of their that the structure itself, people started creating for us. And maybe we are expecting in the month of January there will be a huge population of the Wanchus will be in our campus, and they will install a huge traditional their structure, their house within the campus. And what we are planning, maybe we are thinking in terms of initiating some work focusing on an anthropological understanding about the particular structure which we can initiate from our next financial year, that has a meaning in a complex structure. So that we are basically contemplating, and with this I'd like to end. Thank you.